unmute their microphone up to question section, and participants should not turn off their camera, and participants should not use chat window for good evening, share attendance, share feedback, share PPTs and other details. We will be sharing attendance and PPTs. And attendance and feedback links will be shared to the Telegram, WhatsApp and chat box as well. We are allowing audio and chat option for participants for interaction purpose with the resource person. Please don't misuse it for good morning, good evening like things. And participants who are violating these instructions will create heavy disturbance to the organizers, and such participants will be removed during the session also. Please help us with this. And now I will be handing over the session to Rajalakshmi Madam, HOD.
Thank you, Narayana. Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Good evening, Prabhu sir. Today's resource person. He is from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. Good evening, all the participants. Thank you for your participation. Today is the third day, and I know you are very enthusiastic. And request Mrs. Nirmala to introduce the speaker. Nirmala, please unmute your mic.
Is it audible, madam?
Yeah, now it is okay. Fine, proceed.
A very good evening, one and all. Myself, Nirmala, faculty of PCE and I am very glad to introduce today's speaker, Professor Sri Ganesh Prabhudas. She is currently working as the Associate Professor of Physics in Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, TIFR, Mumbai. She has received the PhD in Physics from TIFR, Mumbai. He has worked with Emory University, USA as postdoctoral fellow for 2 years. He has published more than 52 papers in international journals and several articles in many technical magazines. He has presented more than 80 papers in conferences and has given several invited talks. His research interest includes ultra-fast Metamaterials, high field terahertz, and near field terahertz microscope. Thank you, sir, for accepting invitation to this FT. Thank you, sir. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Nirmala. And then,
hello participants. We will provide with the attendance and feedback at the end of. Very problematic to us, for us organizers. Please don't post good morning and good evening messages.
Yeah.
Use the chat box if you have any problems only. Attendance and feedback links will be shared. Don't worry about the attendance and feedback links. And did all the participants get PPT of day 1 and day 2 shared in Telegram and WhatsApp groups?
The message is yes or no. Yeah, yes. Somebody
is saying yes. Yes, ma'am. Okay, then we will be sharing the PPTs also through Telegram and WhatsApp groups and to your mails also for the next sessions also. Please don't ask for PPTs also in the chat box. If you anybody want any questions to be asked, because during the time of queries, all the participants are coming at a time. It is creating a big burden such that nothing is audible to the resource person. So if anybody want to ask any questions, type in the chat box itself. But I will be asking after the session also. Don't try to attempt everybody at a instant of time.
And you can
please
speak about our live session.
Our session is connected to YouTube channel and it's ECE. Every session will be connected to that channel only. Dear participants, there is a technical glitch at the end of the resource person site. Please stay tuned. And there will be a quiz exam at end of the all the sessions, out of which participants need to score 50% of marks, and every participant has to have 80% of attendance for all the sessions. Then only certificates will be issued. And there is a technical problem. Please be connected.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
So, good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Prabhu, sir. We can hear you, sir. You can hear
me. Presentation?
Yes, sir.
Okay, there was some problem with the I don't know what happened. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Just hold on. There is a call from. Yes, please. Echo is coming, but I am not able to hear anything. I am able to hear echo.
No, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, great. Shall I begin the talk or?
Begin, sir. Continue,
sir. I'm not able to hear. Okay, shall
yes,
I begin
sir.
The talk?
Proceed.
Oh. Start, sir.
Okay, great. So, thank you so much. This is my name, Prabhu. I'm from the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, the Condensed Matter Physics Department. I wish to first thank Professor Lakshmi Narayan for giving me this opportunity to speak to you. I see, and also thanks to the principal of the NITS, and it's a great pleasure, although I have not been able to physically meet you, but it's a great pleasure having to know you people all. And also I see large number of attendance, more than 150 people are attending this. So I hope that I will do some justice to this, and hopefully in the next 1 hour I will be able to convey you about the opportunities in research, problems, and how research funding can be acquired, and finally the intellectual property rights. So if you have any kind of questions or any kind of queries, please feel free to ask. I don't know what is the policy, maybe at the end of the lecture, David. This is our website. I will tell you a little bit about our data institute. So this is the here. Vishakhapatnam is somewhere on the east coast, here in this region, and Mumbai is on the west coast, and this is the expanded view of Mumbai, and we are located in the southern part of Mumbai, which is Kulawa. So this is again an expanded version here. And you can see here, the Tata Institute is situated right next to the sea, the Arabian Sea. And this is where my laboratory is, and my room is. And this is the Pellatron Tower. This photograph is taken from Pellatron Tower. And this is the accelerator that we have. So probably everything under the sun in physics that you can do, you can study in TIFR. And the credit goes to Professor Homi Bhabha, who actually founded this institute, and it was very graciously and very generously funded by Professor Mr. J.R.D. Tata, one of the biggest industrialists of India, with having an enormous foresight. And this is how this place actually got built up, and this is where we have developed our activities. So although today I'm not going to talk about our technical activities, I'll be talking more in general about the research. Now in this talk I will tell you a little bit about what is the research, etc. Many of you already done this, but I will also tell you what are the futuristic research mega projects which are going to come into engineering, science and mathematics. Normally these things are not mentioned any time, but I thought I will give you that. Then comes the next part, which is the research funding, because if you want to be Atmanirbhar, that is what our Prime Minister has said, then you need to be independent and you have to stand on your own feet, and this requires you to work hard and do a lot of research. And that is what China is doing, and that is why they are able to flex their muscles and bully around all of us. So the main key part is the research, and this research nowadays of course requires you to buy expensive equipment, and all this requires money. So this requires you to have research funding, and then you can basically, I'll tell you what type of collaborations you can have. The international, national visits, why they are so important. And then finally, networking, how you go for conferences, symposiums, meetings, etc. So all these things are very, very important. And then finally, we will talk about the intellectual property rights, why they are so important, because they generate patents, you generate copyrights, and these can also help generate a lot of money for the country, for yourself, your institution, your state, everything. So this way you basically generate a lot of money, and that is how all the Western and Japan, Korea and all these countries have created wealth. So we have to also now do these things. So then we will, I'll tell you how far we have come and where we are going. And mainly all of you are from different colleges and engineering colleges and all that. So it's very important for you to know how the future things are changing. So I mean, it's not scary, but just you should be prepared for this, that now this virus has also come in and it has also accelerated certain things. So I'll just brief you a little bit about this. The next part is research. So what are the questions that you ask before taking up a problem? So many of you have already done PhD, but that time probably your guides have already provided you with the research problem. But basically you have to ask these questions, that what is the main question that you would like to answer, and you have to also tell as to why this is so important, this research or working on this problem is so important, or why you should waste your time, energy, funds, efforts, etc. So these things are important because you will be spending a lot of efforts, your institution and everybody, everybody will be spending a lot of time on this. So you have to do this and also hypothesize and work. So that is another thing that you can actually have certain plan with certain idea. Now your hypothesis may be right or may not be right, it's not necessary that it has to be right, because otherwise, you know, everybody will just do the right thing. Why will they do research? I mean, simply start writing paper as soon as you get the idea and you know that it is right, you start writing. So it doesn't happen like that in research. So there's a lot of probability of success and everything. Now, the other thing is you should have an eye for this unusual result, because something that everybody else has missed, but you saw it, and this is something which is very, very important. For example, when you know, these scientists, they are working on certain things, they look at something which has, you know, very unusual behavior or something, and then suddenly you realize ki, yes, there is something which everybody else missed. This is something which I can try. So, for example, polymer chain reaction, all of you already may have read about it, because this virus, if you want to replicate it or his RNA, then you need to use this PCR. That is how they figure out whether you are this Wuhan virus positive or Wuhan virus negative. And the way this happens in within few hours, you know, you can get millions and billions of copies of this virus in a very short time. So how did this happen is because the person who actually discovered this method or invented this method, he just thought, ki, why not I just, you know, do some kind of temperature cycles, and why it cannot work out, and why everybody missed it. And he got this idea while he was driving on some California road on highway. He suddenly struck him, and then he just wrote it, and he said, okay, I'll go back and do it, and it won Nobel Prize for him. So this is something which we should have an eye for, some unusual result, something which everybody else has missed, or some new kind of idea which may appear obvious to you, but it may not be that obvious to others. Now, each material has a particular function, so find the function that you think would be useful. So that is something, you know, I mean, so many materials are there, but if you can find some unusual property of that, that again is a great thing, because that also can lead to a very nice application. Now, research is not a routine job, that is, you must remember. It's also full of a lot of surprises or also a lot of setbacks. So you should be prepared for surprises as well as setbacks. Setbacks should not frustrate you, and surprises should not elate you or start giving you that you are the king of the world or something like that. Because there are always surprises for that also, you know. But what this is needed is you need to read a lot, and you have to keep doing this for a long time, and also keep understanding what these other people are doing and everything. And you have to maintain pace with the latest development, because if you don't know what is happening latest, you might just read something which is already come in the textbook or something, and then you may start, but that you will be already way behind this. And this is what has happened in India. We are lagging in research at many places, simply because there is a huge gap between what is taught and what it is actually happening, the latest development. And therefore, teachers stay away from those. They don't have access to the latest things, and therefore, you know, and also they don't have the latest machinery or infrastructure. That's why they lose out on that. So that should be taken care of. And there is, you also have a peer pressure, because your peers will be doing something fast or very well. So you also have that pressure. And this involves considerable amount of travel. And I will tell you why that is needed nowadays. This is very important. To have this travel, or of course not in this one virus or COVID virus era, but it is quite a bit of travel that is needed, and I'll tell you why this happens. Now, this research may not offer you a huge amount of money, but you need to learn the art of interaction, because while, when you travel, you go to different places, you need to make collaborations and everything, and I will tell you how to do those kind of things also. Science is overall a very demanding master, so you just sit idle, it can become problematic. You may lose. So I'll give you an example that research, you can ask questions, what is the use of this? Whether it has, you know, it's very useful or it is having no use at all. The other is how much of your research will give you fundamental understanding. So either it can be very low or it can be very, very high. So now, for example, if your use of the your research is very low, but its understanding in terms of fundamental understanding is very high, it actually increases a lot of knowledge. So this is an example of what Bohr did. So Bohr actually figured out the model for the atoms and everything that you all know. So in terms of application, there was no application when he actually found it. So in terms of importance, in the fundamental understanding of nature, this was a very key step, a great step. Similarly, around that same time also, Edison, who invented electrical bulb, lot of the recording devices, playing devices, lot of those things. Now, they were all principles were already known. There were no new principles involved. It was just a new invention of these devices or machines that he invented. And these machines were very much useful. So application-wise, they were very high application. But in terms of understanding of any new knowledge or something, there was not much knowledge. I mean, just you know, an application of all the electromagnetic theory and all those. So there was nothing new to that. Now, if you consider high application as well as fundamental increase in understanding, then you can take the example of Louis Pasteur. So Louis Pasteur actually showed that the diseases are caused by all kinds of like virus, bacteria, or protozoal, or all different types. Basically, he said, what he showed was these things happen not because of any curses or any divine or God is angry or some such thing. It happens mainly because of these elements or these other live stocks which actually go inside your body and then they cause problems. So here there is a huge change in the understanding or our fundamental understanding of how diseases happen. He showed that the diseases happen because of these you know, bacteria or viruses or other. While the at the same time, he was also able to develop medicines for that or vaccines for those, and therefore in terms of application also, he got a very high-end application of this, and this actually caused a huge change. I mean, it actually increased the lifespan of people and the population. And he also gave remedy. Yes, you need to have everything clean, quarantining, everything. All those things were formalized, and these methods were now what I mean, you are all familiar with all this. All these things happened because he increased the fundamental understanding. At the same time, he also showed an application of that. So, in terms of application and fundamental understanding, you can take example of Louis Pasteur's research. So, this is something that you know, research has been in. Now, over the years, I mean, initially there was a Stone Age about 2 million BC. Then then came the Bronze Age around 3200. That is where all the metals and everything was started. People started discovering and started using it. So then you had this Iron Age, and then around 200 BC you had this Concrete Age, where you know people started building big cities with huge structures and everything, like pyramids and other kind of castles and everything. Then came, after almost 2000 years, Steel Age, where people actually started having an industrial revolution, and then they also had these steam engines built and everything, steamers were built and everything. So around 1850, there was a huge revolution, and that is the same time when oil was also became a big commodity. So oil and steel created a big revolution. And around 1950, around 100 years, within 100 years, people came to Silicon Age, where transistors and new things, electronics was developed. And around 1990, the nano part came. So everything became so miniaturized that you had the rise of Nano Age. That is what we are already into. And then you also have this around 2020, what is known as a Robotic Age. Now, what is Robotic Age? Basically, Robotic Age is something that you are already seeing. I mean, you already have been using these machines called mobiles, which have already become like a mini computer. And there you have these, what is that, Siri, Alexa, and all of you just talk to them and they tell you something. And this is the next thing, which is the beginning, and it is called artificial intelligence. So by 2040, in another 20 years, this is what is going to take over everything, all our lives, all our activities and everything. So I will talk about this also a little bit. So what are the futuristic global mega projects, which of course I am speaking to physics, so I hope that there are engineering and physics people here. But these are also, you know, across other subjects also, so not only restricted to physics, but I have just... So one is the efficient harnessing of the solar energy, because you know, solar energy is unprecedented and unlimited, and every time, everywhere it is available in India. If you can get into that, it is great. Some of you might just hit up on the jackpot. Then you have fuel, where hydrogen production by water splitting. Because if you can use this hydrogen as a fuel for many of these cars or vehicles, etc., then the output will be just water, and that will be really great, very environment clean. Then you have drinking water purification, which is the biggest problem, because the new wars across countries and everything will be happening because of the drinking water only. If you can purify sea water into drinking water, it will be a great. This is another big mega project. Then you have what is known as material genome. Now, just like human genome was sequenced, you have now all the elements, you have all the theory, all the equations which work the behavior of these different material, you know, elements coming together. So basically, you take say sodium, you take say chlorine, and on computer only you make this molecule called sodium chloride, and then this sodium chloride you make it form into a crystal on the computer itself, and then it will tell you what are the properties of this material. So this is called material genome. So just by simulation you figure out what a particular material will give you, what are the properties it will give you. And then you only fabricate or manufacture that particular material, and then you know that it has the same properties. Just confirm that, and that's it. This is how these topological insulators and all these recent wild materials and everything have been discovered. They are all designed first on computer. They were predicted by computer. These are supercomputers which actually predicted them. And then only those were made and their properties were studied. So this is why I'm saying we are getting into this material. Then the next thing is, of course, the counter-step for global terrorism and crime. So there will be a lot of other inventions which are needed for this. So the understanding of the terrorists, how they behave, what kind of they would use, and all those things. Then you have steps for reducing global warming, just like, you know, these fuel changes and many other things. Then you have robotics and automation that is now going to be part of that. You are going to have miniature drones and big drones and everything, all kinds of things, flying cars and everything. Basically, we use not a science fiction, it's going to become a reality. Then you have what is known as quantum computing, so normal computing, and now you have quantum computing where you can do quantum kind of calculations, very fast computing. And most important thing is going to be the understanding of the brain. That is going to be for the rest of the century. And the space exploration, which you know there is no limitation. So there are all kinds of opportunities in this space exploration. There is no end to it because space is so vast that our entire population is too small for it. So now this brings me back to these conferences. Why it is important to attend these conferences? It is basically to meet scientists from other parts of the world, meet your other scientists within the country, and the idea is basically you discuss and you generate a lot of new ideas. You will also see, you know, there are certain things that you are good at, there are certain things that the other person is good at. If you can generate collaborations, then you can solve certain problems which you never thought of tackling. So, because nowadays these expertises are so evolved that one person cannot become expert of everything. So old times of say Einstein's time or Bohr's time and all that, where, or Fermi's time, where one person could do many, many, many things. You don't have to be like that. It is impossible. But if those people are born now, it will be difficult for them to have this. There are a lot of issues there. So this way, attending conferences, you get what is the state of the art, what is happening latest, and it is like reading hundreds of papers in a very short period. So this actually will help you a lot in attending these conferences, because nowadays you may not have time also to read all the journals, and there are so many journals and so many. So next is you need to get connected and you need to form your own network, because network only now things happen. And I'll give you an example that Professor Arnold Sommerfeld, who was the guide, research of a lot of this. Well, and now you know, the students or the postdocs who work with him, their names are like Werner Heisenberg, Wolfgang Pauli, Peter Debye, Epstein, Bethe, all many of them are big, big names in physics or chemistry, and you know, they're all almost 90%, 80 to 90% of them are Nobel Prize winners. Now this Herbert Frolich, Rudolf Virles, they have not won the Nobel Prize, but they have contributed exciton theories, polariton theories, which are now commonly used. Walter Heidel is not a Nobel laureate, but he developed the entire quantum theory of light. So all these names you will find in the world's topmost chemist, Linus Pauling. Then you have Herbert Kromer. Again, all these are Nobel laureates. This is Edward Condon. Philip Morse. Philip Morse is not a Nobel laureate, but he actually developed a lot of popular related things with Romberg and all. So many of these people that you have read these names, and you will wonder, oh, what a great guide he must be. But it is not an accident that all these people were there together. It's because you have to form a place of excellence, and if so many people work there, some ideas suddenly somebody is, you know, it just strikes somebody, and then you know, you develop new subjects, and then you contribute it for the first time, then you become a big legend. Now you can we'll now go to the research funding part. So before that, you must know how to write a research paper, because this is a very important part, because that actually projects you and your personality. So you must choose your title very properly, and that title should be concise and to the point, because it is like a newspaper title where, you know, you must attract the public attention. then the title should address the main problem you are planning to investigate, because if you just give some general then you have to also consider the fact that basically the summary of your research work, and that should not exceed half a page, and that should give you a brief, that should give the reader brief background of your research area and methods that you are using, so that he may not be able to read the whole paper, but he at least gets an essence out of it, because this is what is now happening nowadays. People may not have enough time to go through all your entire paper and detailed analysis. They may want to just quickly have a look at it. So this is abstract is also very important. Then while writing the main research paper, you should have a very solid introduction where you give includes a brief research background, and you tell why you have chosen this particular topic to work on, and its significance in the field, and then short description of the major issues that, that your proposal is actually addressing, or the question that you are trying to answer. Then you also construct nice literature review. I know it should contain a critical review of the information that you use and you use your work, which you are going to present later, and then it also tells the reader, oh yes, that you have already sufficient knowledge of the topic, and then you are doing so you are giving actually proper due references to all these things. Then you also mention what are the kind of research design and method that you have used. If you have done some theory, you give all the theory, or if you have designed something, you give the design, case study, analysis, etc. And then also tell about the methods that you have, you are planning to use, or you have used, with details or whatever, and also the analysis. Then you can either predict the results or show the results. If you have done simulation or theory, you can say, okay, these are the kind of things which may happen if you design it in this way or that way. And then you can also show the reviewers that, okay, you have an idea at what this research is going to lead to, etc. So basically, if you see what is so if it is an experimental data, then you can also show, okay, it either conforms to something that has been done, or this is something new, which, you know, it's a new idea or something. And then there are also, if you are a biologist or something, there are also ethical considerations and benefits that you have to also state. So physics people normally don't get into this ethical, because the biology people work with animals and human blood or whatever. So they have this issue of ethics. Now coming to writing of the research proposal. So each funding agency will have their own thing. They will give you that template and which you have to use it. And but clearly I have added here, you know, it will have a title page. It will have abstract, which you have to give general purpose idea. Then you have to give specific goals. Then you have to tell how you are going to design your research. What are the methods you are going to use, and what is the significance of this? So this is something which has to come in a short. So this is a basically short summary of what you are going to propose and that you are asking money for. Then comes the introduction, where you tell what is the kind of research problem that you are going to work on, and why you want to do that, what is the purpose of the goals of your research, and what is the significance of your research. All these things will have to come in. Then you give the literature review that, okay, that you know what is happening latest in the literature, you are aware of it, so the those reviewers know, okay, yes, you are not some arbitrary person. Then comes the project narrative, where you will tell the methods, procedures, objectives, outcomes, or deliverables, as they call it, how you will evaluate whatever has is the right thing that has come, and then how will you tell others about this. So it is called dissemination. So either you will present it in conferences or publish it in journals, or you may take patents or whatever. So this is something which you have to tell. And then you will need personnel, how many people are needed, what level they are needed, what kind of training they will get, etc. And finally, of course, the budget and the justification for those projects. So whatever you want to buy or software. Now, when it goes to the reviewers, the important thing that they are going to see is, you know, they very experts there, or they may not understand what it is. So, most key thing is that you should tell what are they going to learn as a result of proposed topics. So, basically, this has to come in with goals, aims, and outcomes, and why it is worth going. So, the reviewers are interested in that only. What is it that you think that you are telling, and what is it significant? And how will you know that you have achieved a certain thing? You will say, oh, this is my conclusion. But you say, oh, on what basis you say that this is valid? So, there should be some way that convince the reviewers that it is valid. So, there is a particular way of presenting. And then you also have, of course, the style. The way you write, it will also form an idea about you, whether you are a scholar, researcher, person, you know, it tells them more about you. And it also tells them whether you are a very creative, logical, analytical, up-to-date person in the literature, you know, your field. And that also basically forms your image about whether you are capable of executing the proposed research project. So, it is like this. Basically, if you sit on these committees, I also have sat, so I know how they actually do. So basically, you know, you have certain amount of money coming from the agency, and when you are evaluating somebody's projects and all that, you have to basically, you know, there are so many other applications. I mean, 50 applications like you. So this you can treat it like a, you know, somebody putting the money on in a race, and where all these horses are going to run. You have to put the money on the right horse. Now, how do you decide which horse is going to be the right one? So that basically comes from, oh, this guy is going to be there, or you basically look at the history of that particular horse, and then, you know, so it is something like that, that kind of job. So basically, if you create a good impression with all your scholarly write-ups and everything, then it's very likely that the reviewers are more likely to accept your thing, your proposal might be good. Now, you can also, many times they also ask you to revise your proposal, but before sending also you can revise it, and this is important. So, you just look at whether you have presented the compelling case, whether you have made your hypothesis explicit. I mean, does your project seem feasible? I mean, say, oh, I will you know, build a lift which will take you from down to the space directly. So, one has to show whether you have done enough calculations properly, what kind of material is needed, what kind of things are needed, whether you have calculated those properly and all that. So all these things one has to take into consideration, whether it is very ambitious, whether it has enough other weaknesses. So all these things actually get counted, and you have to basically convince others, or the reviewers, that yes, that you are and you will be successful. So basically it is like that. So so this one has to be careful about. And now I will tell you all the kinds of you know, for the collaborative things, what are the other agencies which are available. So I have basically listed here. So this is the British Petroleum. They have these those who are working in developing countries or the conservation of environment, so they can have these. You have CIFAR from research program. You have Department of Atomic Energy, India, and Department of Biotechnology, again both India. They actually give scientists and engineers these kind of different kind of employment, and these are for 5 years, 3 years kind of things. then you have this Ramalinga Swami Reentry Fellowship. So your age has to be less than 45 years for 3 years postdoctoral research with 2 years from an overseas laboratory. So this for biology, you get it. Then you have DST, SERB, Ramanujan Fellowship. So your age has to be less than 40 years for that. you have JC Bose National Fellowship, so your age has to be less than 68 years. This way you can join after your retirement to some another institution. Then you have DST Swarna Jayanti Fellowship, you are 30 to 40 years. So many of you, if you are falling in this region, you can also look for this Swarna Jayanti Fellowship. Then you have these Lady Tata Memorial Trust and these brain researchers. So this is for this clinical work or biology related things. You also have this ACRB physical sciences, chemical sciences, engineering sciences. So they fund a lot of these things. Last date was 9th March. Now probably next year it will come. So this is for every 3 years and everything. So you also get the startup research grant. So this year it was 2nd March 2020 was the last date. Of course, this year I don't know how much money will be available because of this virus issue. Our economy facing a lot of this problem. But these are for biological sciences. You can go for this Padmavati Venkateshwara Foundation, CVF. This is in Guntur area of Andhra Pradesh, and they give money for biological sciences. So if you are working in biological or chemical sciences, you can definitely apply for this. So they right now also they are considering this. Then you have Wellcome Trust, which is actually in America, British thing. So they give a lot of money with the Department of Biotechnology India. And so there are different schemes for different areas. So postdoc, 7 to 15 years of PhD, post-PhD or postdoctoral experience. They can also go for 4 to 7 years of this. So a lot of these things are there. They give generous funding for 5 years, and so you can keep looking for this. But this is for biology. Then you have Alexander Humboldt Foundation, Humboldt Foundation, which is the German research for the German part. So there are two levels. One you can go either as a junior level or you can go at higher level. So these are again for duration of 6 to 18 months or 1 year or 3 years kind of thing. Then you have American Cancer Society, which also gives you this kind of thing. Then you have these cancer related thing. Now you also had this Fulbright Nehru Academic for 5 years teaching experience. So if you are below 50 years of age, you can definitely ask for that. Then you have again this British Petroleum for 2 years, you can go for some different projects. And CSIR also appoints. This is a rolling program for 3 years research grants. Then you have again Department of Biotechnology. So those of you in biology, there are a lot of these project grants from 3 to 5 years or 1.5 to 2 years. I'm more familiar with this DST, ACRB. So here again, these core research grants, you have startup research grants, you have high risk award research, you have, and then you also have industry relevant R&D. So industries don't do any R&D, whatever they do is just spam, but that's why government is actually encouraging industry to support industry, you can do something. So they have to also put in some money in this. Then especially for women scientists, you have a lot of these DST scientist programs. For women who have taken a break in their career, the age limit is up to 57 years, they can still write grants and they will be supported for 2 years full salary. So a lot of these, 3 year, 2 year, many of these are available. We also have nanomission. Which is again a rolling program every 3 years they ask. We also have these collaborative, DFG Germany and so India also has a lot of collaborative projects or grants with different countries in Europe, America, Australia. So I will tell you a little bit about that also. This DFG is of course for any researcher and every year it is for 3 years. You also have Bill Gates giving a lot of into this. So what to see here's for these grand challenges, explorations, and all. So these are some what can look at. You also have this James McDonnell Foundation, USA. Okay, somebody asked me a question, what is a rolling program? Rolling program means this program never ends. I mean, it will continue every year continuously. So that is why it is called rolling. So it keeps rolling. So you have applied now, suppose you miss it, you can apply next year. Again, you miss it, again, you can apply next year. So it's like that. So all the time it is running. Sometimes what happens is certain schemes, they open, okay, this is a centenary scheme. So it is valid for on the 100th year and only for 2 years, and then they stop it. So sometimes it happens like that. So for example, this Swarna Jayanti Fellowship. The Swarna Jayanti was for 50 years of our independence. Now it is already coming to now 75. So now they will probably stop this Swarna Jayanti and maybe call it what, a Diamond Jayanti or whatever, Hirak Jayanti, something like that, and they will continue. So now the name will be changed and it will be stopped. So it's something like that. Okay. So then you also have these NSF of USA. They also give scholarship of course, collaborative work, etc. You also have this Wildlife for foundation that also gives things. So those who are interested in biological things or wildlife, they can actually go for this. Then again, to improve this science and technology infrastructure, DST gives a lot of money. Of course, DBT gives it for biology development, and DST gives it for engineering and scientific development. Then we also have these BRICS countries, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and all that. They also do a lot of those many years work. Then you have these France, SEFI Prab, which actually gives India France. So you need two people from India and two people from France for the collaborative work. These are again, they have first February and first July. Each year they ask for these grants, proposals, and then they give giving this money for 3 years. So you also have it for Spain and everything. JSPS from Japan is again another famous one. So there also you can go for 2 years of work. Then you have this Department of IT technology and all that. So they also have collaboration with UK, and there similarly for Russia and Belarus, you can go there for a few years of collaborative work. So 2 years is typically, or 3 years or more than that. Then you have these young investigator grants or program grants from these human frontier science programs. So again, these are for 3 years. Sometimes they announce, sometimes they don't announce, depends on the money which is available. So this is Indigo partnership program for Indo-European innovation sales and all. So you also have this Australia and EU, European Union. They also have this for 3 years and 5 years for different. Some of them are biotechnology funds, but they also have it for engineering. So especially this DFG and from Germany. So these are all, of course, for the biology related with our DFG. You also have this Norway, which gives you grant from their research council. Another thing is this Cambridge University. So this is again, these are all again rolling schemes. So, but these are for very short visits. So using this, you can actually go for a short trip, have this collaborative thing, and then come back. Now this Raman Charbak Fellowship is mainly for the high energy physics. So those who are working in high energy physics can use this and go there. Then you have these DAAD Germany ones, those are the ones, and also with Brazil and Belgium also. So many of these are for short period or 1 to 2 years. So it actually allow you to stay there, those countries, and do research. Then you have Indo-Australia Military Career Fellowship programs also. those who are interested in going to Australia, New Zealand, that side, you can use this Matsume Foundation for Japan for those scholarships. But these are for short time. Then you have Royal Society, again, from 3 months to 1 year to 2 years. And then you have DST and CSIR. They normally give you some kind of money for organizing meetings, symposia, workshops. So why this is important is mainly because these institutions are allowing you international exchange, basically. These are all for international exchange. You actually go there, but you can also call these people and organize different meetings. So that way you get to know those scientists, you get to, you will get a chance to call all these top-notch people. And many times what happens is, discuss with them, you get some new ideas, or they present some state of the art thing and you get new ideas, and then it actually changes your research. Now, I have not put any eligibility because you know, all of you can just write to them. So that's what I am not. Yeah. Now, you can also, if you are a biologist or something, you can also have there they have some requirement that organizers have a PhD and all that. And if you want to do Indo-French, then they need a French collaborator for this. Same thing for this also. And you also have these EMBO, member state or cooperative countries. This way what happens is you are actually going to draw a lot of these international people. So international people come to you, you go to these international people, and that is how the exchange happens. And this is how you build your network, because it is very important for India to build this network. This networking is the most important thing nowadays if you want to really do big research. Because you just saw, I gave you an example that if you have a person like, say, Somerville, and if you are working in a place like that where you have all these big wigs who are working there, definitely you will do some work which will be fundamental, because there are certain ideas which will come to you first time. But for that, you need to be at the forefront. So that is why this is very, very important. And you also have this EWS, Third World Academy of Sciences, which is in Italy. They necessarily organize this for developing countries. So India organizes many times these meetings. Now, those of you who want to just travel, there are many travel grants that you get. So from DPT, DST, or International Brain Research Organization, ICMR. So there are certain eligibilities about your current age and everything. So INSA, CSIR, DAE, BRNS, GOES, ISRO, they also give these Ratan Tata, Dujway Ratan Tata, they also give these travel grants. So if you are going for PhD or if you are going to spend certain time there, so they will pay for your time. Then if you want to develop entrepreneurship or technology development, then again, welcome trust of UK, but this is mainly for biology. So you can apply for that. So these are all biology or ecology related work. So you can go for this outreach and everything, any of those type of things. Then you also have these biotechnology, biocare, DST, utilization of scientific products of the retired people. So those of you who are retired, they are, I mean, nowadays people are active till they are 80. 85. So why not use their expertise? So for this DST has this scientists, users kind of. Now, so basically I have given you many, many things up to this basically travel grants, research funding grant, collaboration travel grants, then meeting organization grants, etc. And many times there are certain fellowships even after your retirement you can continue. Suppose you are a woman and you have taken a break with your career. After a break of 2 years, again you are coming back to work. You still have a lot of opportunities. You can build your career again. So all these opportunities are already existing. So I hope you had some idea about this. And now I come to the intellectual property rights, patents and copyrights. So the important thing is economies actually runs on scientific progress, and this is a very key part. For centuries, the main strength of the civilization was basically labor and land. So that's the reason why kings would actually win a particular land, and they will basically catch all those people and then convert them into labor, and then they will start building their own empires. So basically land and labor was the key for those civilizations. But after this industrial revolution, 1800s, it went into this capital and then energy. So why capital? Is because now you could actually build factories, and you could generate large amount of different kinds of products, and that actually needed large amount of energy. So you develop basically electrical energy, you develop oil based steam engines or oil based engines, and then run the machines on that, and then develop, you basically start consuming energy, and you generate large amount of capital. So that is how all these big companies come up, and then they start ruling the world or a given country like that. So that is how you have these big names like IBM, Intel, and all that. They're all basically capital, and all these Exxon Mobil or big oil companies, which are basically the energy. And now, around the 20th century and early 21st century, it is the era that we are in. Now knowledge and information is going to be the key. So that is why all these gadgets that you use, they all connect you directly to internet. And you have Google, which is basically collecting all the data that you are searching for. All the things that we are talking and everything is being listened to by all these. And they're all collected by these robots. And these robots actually analyze this, because no, it's not possible for a human to analyze. So these are all done by this artificial intelligence. And those companies which will have all the data will have access to this knowledge and will have access to this information. And that is how they will basically rule our lives. So they will give us all the relevant information, all the relevant knowledge. And many times later, you might have to even pay for it. Right now, Wikipedia is freely available, but later they may suddenly say, okay, now we have built enough knowledge base, now you start paying for getting the knowledge access. So they will start charging you. So some such kind of things can happen in the future. So that is why they are trying to collect as much knowledge as possible from all parts of the world, from all kind of people. So these are the companies which will now come up, which will have access to all this. Now, technology and knowledge actually will run the economies of future. That is the reason why it is very important for India to... Yes, please. So, we will look at this IPR, where patents and copyrights is very important from the point of view. I mean, you are in engineering colleges or whichever colleges that you are teaching. This is a very, very important thing, that you start generating ideas which you can copyright or patent it. So the most important thing for the World Trade Organization agreement, it actually provides you different standards for patents, copyrights, related rights, trademarks, geographical indicators. Then you have industrial designs, layout designs of integrated circuits, protection of trade secrets, and then plant varieties. So these are, of course, the listed part. So patents, you basically have an invention, so which means that it's either a new product or a new process which involves an inventive step and capable of industrial application. So these are the things which can be given to patent. Now, tomorrow you say, oh, I found E equal to MC square. I have developed some equations. Can I? So that is not something that a principle or H nu is equal to E, where H is Planck's constant and nu is frequency. So these kind of things cannot be patented because these are principles which are valid forever. You have to have a new invention and technology which has not been anticipated by any publication or document used public or something elsewhere in the world. But then you get exclusive rights for that. Now, patent is an exclusive right which is granted by a country to the owner of the invention. Make, use, manufacture, and market that particular invention. So suppose you make a particular device which is completely your invention, you can actually take a patent and you can now manufacture it, you can market it, you can do all these kinds of things, and nobody else can actually duplicate this without you your concept. So for this, if some company wants to do it, they will have to pay you. So this is how you earn money. So if some foreign company pays you, you earn dollars. So this way you earn this. Now somebody asked the patent versus journal publication, what is more important, etc. Now that is decided by your particular institution, because in journals you publish something, say, new knowledge or something, and patent is something by which you can actually have an idea by which you can earn money for you, yourself, your institution, your state, your country, and then later, once you get the patent, you can publish it in the journal. So you can do that. So for example, I'll give you my example. We had invented a new design for our Terahertz source. So the patent guys told me they didn't understand the importance of that, and they started delaying it. And my student's PhD was getting stuck, so he was anxious to get it quickly published. So finally, we published it, and then later we, of course, once you publish it, you can't take patent. Somebody else, then it becomes a public knowledge. So people can use that design and make a high power Terahertz. So something like that can happen. So you can give this patent, which is like a property right, and you can give it to somebody. You can get inherited by your children. You can assign them. You can sell it to some other company or license. So products, processes are patentable if they are new. They involve inventory steps and they are capable of industrial product. Then you can also, this can be revoked by some state. I'll give you an example. Suppose you invent something by which you can get rid of this COVID or Wuhan virus, and then you say, unless you pay me some 1 lakh rupee per that medicine, I'm not going to tell you. Then under such circumstances, state can actually revoke this and say that, look, because this is for good of everybody, so we cannot do it. So, amount is unthinkable by any. So, for example, there is this remdesivir and Tamiflu and this kind of medicines which they are saying for this COVID virus or whatever, Wuhan virus. Now the company which has made that, they can charge, give me $1 billion and then you can have the medicine. So they can actually earn like that. So this is how pharmaceutical companies make huge amount of money, and they are very happy if there is a virus or there is any disease causing havoc. So right now, those are the companies which are most happy, because this can bring them billions of dollars, not million, billion, absolutely billions of hundreds of thousands of crores of dollars they can do. So that's why they are very happy and they are running behind this. Now, if your thing is causing damage to humans or animal, plant, environment, then they cannot be granted. So, suppose you go for this atom bomb patent or something, it may not grant you. So there are certain TRIPS agreement which allows you 20 years of rights, and sometimes they can also give you 5 years of rights and all that. So it depends on country and depends on this. Now patent, of course, is patentable if it is not inventiveness and usefulness. It should not be an obvious. So for example, if you say you have invented a machine which can kill mosquitoes, and it doesn't require any other energy, and very all these things you tell, that is a great novelty, this, that, and finally you somebody asks you, we would like to buy it and that machine, and then you just give them two plain pieces of that granite which are very polished, and you say, okay, whenever the mosquito sits on it, just bang it like a clap, and then the mosquito will get you. So this is a this is something which is quite obvious, and that can actually make a mockery of the. So that's why such kind of thing won't be granted. So it has to be really novel, and it also should be very useful. then you can also patent our particular process, method or manner of manufacture. You can also patent a machine or apparatus or a substance. So suppose you design a particular broom in a certain way that, you know, it can clean the floor very well, you can actually patent it. I mean, you cannot say that it's just a broom. I mean, how? No, it's not like that. You can definitely patent it. For example, there are certain designs people have done where just by pressing by leg, you can, you know, it can dispense you the hand sanitizer without touching the hand sanitizer bottle. And then it will also suddenly start the tap just by touching the feet. So such things, apparatuses can be patented. They are not patentable. Now, following are not patentable in India. These are inventions which claim substances intended for food, medicine, drug, alloys, optical glass, semiconductor, intermetallic compounds. So for example, if you say, oh, haldi, that is turmeric, I will use it as a medicine. Then it is not allowed in India, but in America they tried to allow such. Therefore, there was a big fight. Also, there was a big fight about basmati rice. So suppose somebody comes in Andhra and say, okay, I will take patent for making this pasarattu, and then everybody who eats pasarattu has to pay. So that is nonsense, because you know for thousands of years you have been eating that, and you have made a kind of you know food. So that's why certain things are not really patentable. But you develop some new things, they are definitely. Inventors, again, these are not patentable in India. Inventions contrary to law, morality, curious to public health. Also, you say, okay, I have you know, discovered Raman effect, so can you? So, again, this is not patentable. You can also say something perpetual machine. Oh, my machine doesn't require energy, it will continue to go. And so such things are not really allowed. Also, these substances obtained by mixing powders and everything, which is also really not allowed. Then you also cannot do, you know, this thing applicable during manufacture and agriculture or horticulture related things and medical surgery. So these are all the things which are, if you see that these are, many of these are very useful for the public and for the good of a large public, people have not used it. But in America, people can actually take patents on these and start looting poor people. So that is the reason why India, these things are protected. Now, normally terms of patent in India are 5 years from the date of filing of the patent, 7 years from the date of patent. You can also have it for 20 years. When you submit the patent documents, they will give you provisional specification of the ownership, and then complete specification has to be submitted within 12 months. So this process can take, you know, maybe a year or a few months to a year, depending on the patent type. And then while you name the inventors, either you can name all the persons who contribute towards its development, or all the persons who actually made an intellectual contribution towards it, those also can be, you know, awarded. This depends on you, your choice. And the person who provides this idea to you know, to produce the invention, but the items are made by different people. Suppose you design a machine, but get all those parts made by so many different people. Different workshops. Those workshop people cannot be given part of this patent. You can, because you have assembled it together, you designed, you constructed it, everything. So you have the drawings. So therefore, you, it is basically patent portion. So you can also protect expression of ideas in terms of, you know, material form. Suppose you have written a novel or some such, that also can. So that is something you can also call it as a copyright, and you can have these, you know, literary, drama, art. All these things can be protected by this, and you can protect them by using this sound recording, film, broadcast. The rights which are granted to you as a copywriter, you can copy the work, you can issue copies to this public, you can rent or loan this work to public, can perform this in public, and you can also communicate this work in public. So for example, if you are doing outreach of your work, that is possible. Now when you do this collaborative research, many times collaborating partners have joined for copyright, so you must have realized this wide publicity journals. And students also hold copyright to whatever they create, their software, database, pieces. So you can allow them to have that. And ownership, copyright by staff, normally what happens, these are the things which are faced by the institutions. So the works created by this further education or higher education, so these are carried out at institution premises. So your college or institute will give, allow you to use their resources like electricity and land and area and everything. But many times these are given to journals and all that, but you can also, they can also ask for copyrights. It just depends. So I have basically given you the overall thing. Now this last two things I will mention before I end, before I stop this talk. And one is, there are, you know, independent, you know, different patents have been filed and granted, you know, after our independence, very few are granted, mainly because of our socialist policies. But now that, you know, the students cannot keep having only theoretical knowledge. They have to have this practical hands-on experience. Otherwise, you cannot make them really employable. And then the other thing is, there have been no international travels, no exchange of ideas. So we have been always completely isolated from Western progress, and only we have industries mainly, you know, as a heavy industry, and there has been no high tech manufacturing, and that is the reason why China and other countries can actually bully us, because, you know, even the computer or the mobiles or whatever that you are using, nothing of that has made in India. So this is the big issue. And we don't have any photonics industry, electronics industry, space or biotech innovation industry, nothing. So unless, you know, you make these spaces open, a lot of engineers have to be trained into that, then only we keep popping left, right, center, but we don't keep anywhere. But now we have to keep value for these copyrights, because copyright and patent is something which actually gives you exclusive rights, and copyright is something that you have created your artwork or whatever, your research paper or something, or thesis or something, to which you hold all the rights. It could be software also. So these are the things. Patents allows you to give you, you know, for machinery or other processes, while copyright is for your creative work of art and all this. Now, patents are very important for the development of our economy in this century. So the students have to be trained to think very innovatively by their teachers. It is basically your responsibility to do that and inculcate that kind of culture. Now, and why I'm saying this is because you will also see that this artificial intelligence is coming up very fast. Already you have this Chia Choice or Alexa, Siri, Cortana. All these are already right now voice related help they are giving. Later they are going to become the tutors. I'm telling you, these will be the teachers who will be teaching each and every individual student on their laptop or on their mobile. And there will be companies which will actually allow online courses where these robots will actually teach the student, and they will have millions and millions of students and their feedback coming into them. And as a result, they will basically be tuning their teaching methods, you know, in real time. So even at 2 a.m. in the morning, they will have, the students will have teacher available for give a lecture and train him on certain things. So basically, they will only come to the colleges for doing practicals. And if that happens, then there will be companies which will say, why at all you want to have college? I mean, you can just directly come. We will give them training online or all on the job, and then, you know, we will have a trained person. So they will just give them all the relevant technology and training, and they will say, okay, you complete these courses from this Coursera site or some particular company which is offering you different courses, you earn that certificate and we will just pay you. Then the need for classroom, need for colleges will not exist. So one has to be very careful, unless you give them a lot of practical hands-on things, your relevance will go away. So this is very, very closely going to happen, because now this virus has already accelerated this kind of processes, so one has to be careful. So try to, you know, take as many patents on new processes, devices, circuits, designs, but all these would require you to train these people in a different way, think in a different way. So that is what my advice is. So thank you very much. I hope I bore you much with this, and I give you all the relevant information. So thank you once again to all of you, your principal, Neet College, and also Professor Lakshmi Narayan for giving this opportunity to speak to so many of you, and thank you for all of you for coming in such a large number. So thanks a lot. So now it is open for questions and answers.
Participants, I will be asking the question answers.
Yeah,
I have written all the questions. I will be asking the resource person.
Start asking question. Hello? Professor Lakshmi Narayan?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, your voice is very small. Can you be loud, please? Yes?
Yes, sir. Gautam asked
a question, sir. Book chapter is Scopus. Important on Jarvan Jarvan. What
is Scopus? What did you say? Book chapter is Scopus.
Your voice is extremely small. I'm not able to actually hear what you are saying. What did you say?
Audible, sir.
Rebo, sir.
Now it's audible. What did you say? Yes.
Is it audible now, sir?
Yes,
book chapter in Scopus or journal in Scopus, which one is better, sir?
Journal in Scopus or what is the first part?
Book chapter.
Publishing a book chapter in Scopus.
No, journal will be better, because book chapter is something that once you establish yourself, you can definitely do it, no doubt about that. It depends on, because with journal, what happens is book chapters, books may not be that much easily available, because they're quite expensive. But journals are disseminated at many, many, many places. They have a lot of citations and everything. All the researchers will first look for these journals. And book chapters are for very specialized things. So that can happen much later. So once you establish yourself, you can do these things. So it is important at the beginning of your career to build your career using the journals and very high-end journals. If you publish, then you build your reputation. Is that clear?
Okay, sir. Next question.
Hi, Dr. Prabhu. I have a question.
CN Ramesh asked a question, sir.
Yes?
About impact factor.
Yes?
What is impact factor and will it increase after publishing a paper?
Impact factor is basically where you publish a particular article in a journal. So what it does is how many times that particular article has been cited by others. So this is something which tells you. So for example, suppose Lancet, which is a medical journal, that has a 59 as impact factor. So what it means is, suppose you publish one paper in Lancet, then it will be cited by 60 people, 60 times on an average in a month. This is what it means. I mean, this paper would be cited by almost 60 times. This is the probability, or this is the high probability with which this will happen. So that is why people try to publish it in high impact journals. Now, you, if your work is of that high quality, it's quite natural that it will get published.
Okay, sir. One more question from Spandana, madam.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Yes. Yes, please. The question from Spandana, madam. Yes.
Yes, sir. Is there any age limit? Postdoctoral
fellow. Is there any age limit about?
For PDF, sir, postdoctoral fellowship.
No, there is no age limit. The highest age is 57 years if you want to go for that particular woman thing. But otherwise, PDF has no such age limit. Normally, nobody puts things like that.
Yes, sir. One more question from Ramesh, sir. Do a student get PhD if his work is
preferred? His work is If his work is
claimed for a patent.
So the thing is, if you this is where the problem is. So I will tell you example of my student. So he because we wanted to go for a patent, we could not publish those results. So he was getting delayed. So he was very nervous, and he said it is best if I can patent jaane do baju mein. At least I should publish it. So because of that, patent was taking long time, and those people were also not very competent in giving a patent, processing the patent. So we published it, and then he got it. Now the thing is, he would have had many other publications then probably he would have said, okay, I can wait, take a patent and then publish it. So what happens is, patent granting can get delayed. So it can delay the paper publication, and then that can make the student nervous. So because then they'll say, he doesn't have a publication or something. So therefore, one has to be very careful in this. So this is a decision of the guide and the other, the student and the faculty of that particular institute.
Hi, Dr. Prabhu. I have a question.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Navin. Yes.
Yes, Navin ji, boliye.
Prabhu sir.
Yes.
Applying patent for.
Applying patent for? Yes. What did you say?
Does applying patent cost any money?
Yes. It depends on which. Suppose you want to go for Indian one, it will cost some 30,000-40,000, and if you are going for international one, then it costs several lakhs. So Indian one is better, so because it can happen below 30,000-40,000. So that is the thing.
Navin here.
Okay. One more question, sir.
Hello.
Patent.
Hello.
Navin here, sir.
By the advertising reason.
Professor Navin, can you explain later? Professor Lakshmi Narayan ji asked the question, because otherwise there is a lot of clutter. So Professor Lakshmi Narayan ji, please ask question.
Yes, sir. One more question, sir. Patents can be promoted or only by the advertising?
Patents can be
promoted by the owner itself or only chance through the advertising agent.
It is possible both can do it. Actually, once you get patent, then it goes into their repository, and then nowadays, Google search can also can bring your patent up. And if you advertise it or promote it, it's an additional advantage, but that just depends. you have to know where to go and advertise it, something like that.
Okay sir, one more question sir.
Hello.
Yes. Can unemployed women apply for FAPES without any institute collaboration?
Say it again, without any institute collaboration, what was the first part of the question?
Can unemployed women
apply for FAPES? Can unemployed person take payment? Is that the question?
Applying for
you are saying can an unemployed person apply for a patent? Is that the question? Then the answer is yes, anybody can apply for a patent so far as he has invented new method, new process, or he has a new design, or he has developed new machine. So he doesn't have to be part of any institution or something. If he is part of that institution, then maybe, you know, so several lakhs of rupees for international patent etc. can be paid by the institute, but otherwise he himself can do it.
Sir, Navin here.
Hello.
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 Sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah. Hello, hello.
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 Yeah, Navin here.
Hello.
Yes,
hello.
Sir, regarding the question is, nowadays what's happening in the education system? Hello.
Yes sir, you can continue. Sir,
yes sir, the man-made people and all, they're what they're expecting for the faculties, particularly faculties, they have to get the patents, they have to get the grants, and they have to write some proposal, something and all is mandatory now. Nowadays in the education system is very difficult to getting the patent, and at least you can brief, give the idea, some share some links and all, how to get the patents very easily, and how the best proposals we can able to write it, and what about the list of scopus journals, and if we'll provide some links and all, if we'll provide some materials for that, some formats or some materials or some links. It's
okay.
Really better for us to survive in the education system. Nowadays, it's very difficult. They are very concentrating very concentrating on the budget projects and like that. They are not expecting that what faculty is teaching or not.
So this is what is happening because you know, research is like a lottery, as I told you. Your idea may or may not work, but one has to keep working. Similarly, when you are generating patent or you are generating a particular process, one has to try out different processes, and then suddenly you may hit upon some jackpot. It is just like a lottery. So there is always this uncertainty involved. So that is why networking is important, because you know, you may be working alone, you may not get idea. So you have to work and collaborate with large number of people or form groups, and then do it together. Because as I told you at the beginning of the lecture, it is impossible for an individual to do work like that Einstein or Fermi or like that, because their time was different. Their time, you know, the overall knowledge was also limited, journals were limited, you just knew one, two journals and you knew what was happening in the world. Now you have thousands and thousands of journals, it is impossible for you to keep track of what is happening in a literature. I'm telling you, it is impossible, just humanly impossible. In fact, nowadays people are talking about the artificial intelligence may tell them what is relevant work that is happening somewhere, and it may start telling you what research to do on. So this is where, you know, foreign countries are now moving towards, and we are still stuck with these old technologies. But anyway, what I'm trying to tell you is that you need to have a big group coming together, and one has to now work, develop this culture of working together with a lot of people. Yeah, that those individual, you know, working alone on some island and all those days are gone. So this you take it from me. Because what happens is you call a lot of students, a lot of faculties, you know, a lot of new ideas keep coming in, and somewhere you make a breakthrough. So that is the reason why China is progressing, is because they have made this education, high quality education, even at large amount of population. If you involve large number of people, then the success probability increases. So it is like this. Suppose the probability of success is 1 in 1,000, you have to work for 1 year, then China would actually put in 1,000 groups in that. So there are 1,000 people who are working. So definitely in 1 year, one of them will be successful. But in India, ours is a poor country. So they will say, we will only give 10 people only. So now the 10 people will have to work for 100 years. Then only they will, one of them will be successful. So this is the probability. So it is not really possible. So that's the reason why many times Indians have to work on something others have.
Hello.
That can change only when you involve large number of people. So for example, if you involve 10,000 people or 10,000 groups, now in 1/10 of a year you will be able to successfully get to that. It is like that.
Yes, Prabhu sir.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Hello.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, Deepak. Yeah, I want to put one question regarding plagiarism, sir.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, I want to put some query regarding... I want to get some clarification regarding plagiarism, sir.
Yeah, plagiarism, yes.
Yeah, plagiarism, sir.
Yes, yes. You want... are you asking questions?
Yeah, I just want to get, suppose from my own published paper, how much percentage I can, from my own paper, how much percentage I can copy, sir?
See, the rule is that your paper is not published in the journal. The copyright is in the journal. So, actually, you cannot copy anything from their thing into your part. That is what is the law says. But depends on now a lot of things. Because suppose that journal's publication is part of your thesis, then how can you ask them to rewrite each and every part? Part of that, you basically modify those lines. And even if I think, is it 20-25%?
No, I mean, sir, is there any guidance?
Yes.
Sir, that percentage, is there any guideline that that percentage could be copied from my own article?
About? Percentage can be? What did you say? Hello?
How much percentage I can copy from my own article, sir?
He's asking for
self-plagiarism. If you have paragraphs or something, you have to actually give the reference there. Yes, this is what has been copied. But if you don't give and you just simply copy it, what I mean by copy is you have to put it in the double exclamation mark inverted marks. So it is like showing the entire paragraph in the italics or something like. Then probably it is allowed with your reference. But if you copy them as if part of the normal article, that is called self-plagiarism.
But it sometimes.
Yes, happens. Your voice is.
Yeah, it happens sometimes that if you Google something and if you get some picture or something, and then it is showing a plagiarism.
Some picture
So,
wait, some picture as a plagiarism, I didn't understand. So what do you mean by that? It's a figure which is copied, or it's a particular image that has been copied.
But when you copy something from the Google, that is showing 100% plagiarism or something like this, it is showing.
If you copy from Google, you have to also see what are the copyrights of that particular image. So if you give those copyrights of that particular image assigned, then because you have to take permission for doing this. Suppose you write a book chapter and you put in different graphs from different people, you have to take permission of that journal, otherwise they will charge you $150, $200, like that. You must have already...
Plagiarism.
But technical definition of plagiarism is in a sentence, if there are more than 8 words which are being in the same order, then it is considered plagiarized, something like that. If we just careful, so we don't have 8 words in same line repeated. Yes. Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, thank you.
This is Narayana, sir.
Yes, sir.
Publishing our work in book chapter or publishing our work in journal, which will be weightage?
Actually, both of them carry the weightage, but publishing it in journal, you will get more citations rather than in a book chapter, because book chapter will be kept in, it will be very restricted circulation. Journals, there is a much larger circulation. So, if your work is very novel and all those, then people prefer to put it in a journal. And if you are doing a review or you are writing something for larger public domain thing, I mean, for general public domain thing, then you write chapter. So, it depends on who is evaluating this kind of thing. But people normally look for journals because that tells you what quality of research output is there. Book is something which you write when you have already established. Does that answer the question?
Sir, and one more question, sir. No, madam. How is PDF different from PhD, sir? Any extra work has to be done.
How is PDF different from PhD, na?
Yes, sir.
PDF is postdoctoral fellowship. So, postdoctoral fellowship is after you have done your doctorate. Now you have to establish yourself as an independent researcher. So this is PDF will allow you to work on some problem which you can independently take on your own and solve. See, PhD is something that your guide is guiding you basically. Ki, haan bhai, ye karo, wo karo, then you do those and you get your PhD. But postdoctoral fellowship is something where your guide won't stand next to you while you are assumed to be matured enough to think on your own and solve that particular problem. And then when you come as a faculty, that time as an independent researcher, you can actually start your own program, which is completely different. So this is something which is expected out of you. So this is how, this is the difference between a postdoctoral fellow and a PhD. Research. Does that answer her question?
Yes, sir. And if any participant want to ask questions, can
any participant?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now the question. There is some Devidas Maruti Rao Wadekar, he is requesting some annotated shared content or something.
No sir, decline.
No sir, please decline sir.
I am declining, but it is coming, this window keeps coming again and again and again.
Okay sir.
Can you ask how many days it takes to get patent in India? That actually depends on many times it can take few months to a year.
Okay sir, thank you sir. Now the session will be handed over to Srinivas Naidu sir for vote of.
Thank you.
Respected Dr. V. Rajalakshmi Garu, Professor and HOD, Department of ECE, ANITS, and Professor S.S. Prabhu Garu, DCMPA, PMS, AFR. I am Srinivas Naidu, Assistant Professor, Department of ECE. On behalf of ANITS and entire participants, first of all, extending my sincere thanks to the resource person, Professor S.S. Prabhu Garu, for accepting our invitation and making today's event a grand success. Today, we have learnt many new things such as recent areas in research post-COVID-19, writing research proposal, intellectual property rights, patents and copyrights, collaborative research and many things. I also thank our participants for their patience listening. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Professor Lakshmi Narayan, and thank you, Principal, and all other faculties. More than 240, 250 people attended.
Thank you so much for your happy information.
I hope they all had a nice time. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure. Shall I log out now? Shall I leave the meeting now? Professor Lakshmi Narayan, shall I leave?
Yes, sir.
Can I left now?
And the participants? You can leave today and tomorrow the session will start again at the same time at 8:45.
Regarding today's feedback form, sir.